institutions is Texas Christian University, which unfortunately succumbed to my Oklahoma State Cowboys. Jim?
Board meeting after worship.
Board meeting after worship today. I also call attention to the flyer we have in our bulletin today honoring all of our veterans on Veterans Day weekend. We celebrated Veterans Day on the 11th, Thursday. I would ask that all veterans please stand and be recognized. Roger said that, and this is a true statement, that spouses serve as well as the people involved in the services. And he would like to recognize those at this time, too. Any other announcements? Yes, Audrey.
I have a couple. To begin with, we're going to have a sign-up sheet starting next week for if anybody would like to purchase or even donate poinsettias for our sanctuary for the season. That'll be coming up. Also, starting on the 28th, after the first day of Advent, I'm going to be needing readers. If somebody wants to read each week, let me know, and I'd be glad to have you, or, you know, kindly say, hey, you're doing it. You know, things like that. And we're also going to try something new. Starting next week, we're inviting our choir members to come back, at least to sit up in the choir loft to start singing up there. I think it'll look pretty good up there to have people sitting again singing. Don't look that way, but that's it for right now.
Roger.
Okay. And Audrey forgot.
What?
Next Sunday, what's happening after our worship service next Sunday?
Oh, no.
No.
Is it decorating?
We're preparing a sanctuary.
Oh, no, is that the 21st next week?
Yes.
Yes.
Oops, I'm sorry. Yes, we're going to do a Sunday decorating.
The 21st?
It's after Thanksgiving.
It's before Thanksgiving. The Sunday before, because...
The Sunday after Thanksgiving is the hanging of the grain service.
I got lost track.
Yeah.
That's what you get for getting COVID. You lose everything.
No, time just flies.
Time is flying.
So we're going to do it on a Sunday because a lot of people think, you know, while they're here, let's do it.
So exactly what are we doing next Sunday?
We are decorating the sanctuary.
Decorating the sanctuary next week during the service.
No.
After.
After the service.
To get it ready for our hanging of greens program during Thanksgiving.
All right, so as a recap, next Sunday we will have a celebration of decorating the sanctuary, and that will be after the service.
Yes.
Yeah. Did I get it right?
Yes.
Yeah, you did.
Eventually. So.
Also, I was very much surprised last week for the expressions of
appreciation.
Yeah, that's it. And thank you for being a congregation for a little over 18 years now. I will say this, that Jim Long, your board chair, lied to me. He said he wanted to have a few words after the benediction about the Recovenant Sunday, but then again, perspective, maybe he was just shrewd because that's a biblical way to live. Jesus tells us to be shrewd. So anyway, overwhelming and a little tearful Sunday afternoon reading the card. So thank you very much.
And we definitely do appreciate everything you do. Any other announcements? If not, let us begin our worship service. of worship this morning comes from Psalm 146. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long. Let us continue now and with our opening hymn, verses 1 and 2 of Psalm 618, How Firm a Foundation.
You ever have a bruise on your Christian body? Yes, you do. There are times when things are hurt. What do you do for that? I mean, for bruises, you can put cream on it, and you can put ice on it, and you can just wait for it to clear up. You pray. You pray a lot. Because it's not going to just get better if you don't think about it and work on it. It's like your skin. You gotta take care of it, because it's what holds together. Physically, mentally, spiritually, that's God. And you have to have a connection with Him to get rid of your bruises, to get rid of your hard times, and to share your happy times. See, people forget that a lot. They think that the only time you go to God is when you're in need of something. And that's not it. Unless it's a really big, wow thing. You don't think about thanking God right then. I thank God every time I'm on the road and I go by accident. It's not me. And I pray for those that it is. That's happened to. So little things like that take some of the bruising off of you. But the only thing you can rely on is God's love. And He will take care of you. Spiritually, mentally, and physically. So this week, we're going to try to turn things over to God instead of trying to do everything ourselves. And I know that He will take care of us. He is in control. But a lot of times we don't open the communication door. We're like, we're human. Sometimes we don't communicate well, right? Yeah. I know that I don't. But with God, He can communicate with you if you just listen. Listen with your heart, listen with your head. And let's clear up the bruises on our Christian body. Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, we know that there are times when we make mistakes, when we do things that we are not paying attention to, and we bruise our spirit. We know that for our skin there's balms and there's lotions that we can take care of our skin. But we know with our heart and our spirit, we need you. So dear Father, be with us this week as we try to communicate more with you and to keep the bruising of our Christian life to a minimum. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And thank you for coming.
You can do it for a week.
I can do it for a week.
Oh, I made it.
Yes, Judy always says, can we do that for a week? Maybe yes. But hopefully this year, we meaning Lord Jean and myself, did not miss anyone on the veterans list. Please tell us if we did. But so it, in the past, yeah, it's been difficult to keep up with everybody. Because really, in this area, we have so many, a fine heritage that we have in this area. So, and definitely a heritage worth celebrating and honoring. So, joys of the past week, or looking ahead. Yes, Betty Boudreaux. Yes, so Thanksgiving with the Texas crew and a return heirloom.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Many blessings. Many blessings.
Yes. So I will say, fear not, though, we will have music next week, even with Betty not physically being with us, because the technology of the day allows us to have recordings for her to be a part of us, even in her absence. So. You can take a deep breath. We'll be fine. Others?
Well, we're looking forward. Wes's birthday will be a week from Monday. So his brother lives in Kansas City. So we're going to go to Kansas City and hopefully, not sure if we're going to go in person, we're going to see Kansas City and Dallas. So I don't know if we're going to go to the stadium because it's an outdoor stadium. And we're not sure we want to be in the cold.
Yes.
So that will be a game time decision whether we go to the game or we watch it in the comfort of his brother's recliner. So.
Sure.
So we're looking forward to spending a weekend with his brother.
Birthday celebration with family.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes. Joy.
Yes, we had a wonderful family reunion at the lake last week. Mom had a uneventful kidney biopsy on Tuesday. It was postponed one day, but she came through fine, and Megan's birthday is Tuesday, of course. That's all she's talked about since we picked her up yesterday, is can we celebrate today? Well, I'm taking her to see Grease. That's
wow.
Her very favorite, very favorite movie, so that was her surprise this morning.
Wonderful, wonderful.
She'll be a whopping 29 on
Tuesday. Oh, my gosh.
And
wow.
She's been at this church since day one.
Yes. Wow. Whopping 29. Oh, happy birthday, Megan. Wow. Jim?
Yesterday we had our community breakfast with Roy. I think the highest number I heard we served was 20. We had several to-go orders also, which we're pleased with. And additionally, we did some yard work. At least 9, maybe 10 or 11 folks that helped, which made it a much lighter day, except, of course, for Paul.
Yes.
I'm sure we worked him to death.
Or near death, yes. So, yes, the breakfast with Roy, the yard beautification, really. And it was a wonderful day to have people involved and to serve our community. Yes. Judy?
Paul is now a ward member of the working class. He started Friday, and he's really enjoying it so far, so that's good.
Wonderful. Yes, we do celebrate our children moving forward and getting some jobs there, yes. A point of, in our prayer concerns, a point of joy. Dan Kruger had positive results from his tests that he was a little anxious about. From our first service, prayer concerns, Mary Beth Meyer's neighbors, both of the couple passed away within about a 2 week time span. They both had some health considerations. The wife passed away, and then the husband passed away shortly after that, and he was in the hospital at the time. But the Gooney family, and their last name is spelled G-U-I-N-E-Y, Mary Beth's neighbors, and Pat Baker is having to look at a surgery before the other surgeries can be done. I think she's looking at a hernia surgery before she has her shoulder surgery coming. So she always has a difficult time in navigating her way through her through health concerns. But those were prayer concerns shared this morning in our first service. May our Lord be with you.
With you also.
Lord, we come with many activities and events of celebration, birthdays and celebrated family relationships, new opportunities in the workplace, new minister, ongoing ministries that have that take a little bit of an upturn there. We are thankful for this opportunity to be the family of God, the community of faith in this time and place, sharing gifts and skills, sharing encouragement with each other, sharing prayer and praise with each other. And we thank you for meeting us here as Scripture defines where your presence is in worship, where two or more are gathered in your name, you are in our midst, and your Spirit gives us joy and purpose and renewal and forgiveness and grateful hearts. Lord, we look on the horizon and see the holiday season quickly upon us with Thanksgiving and Christmas even, making us aware of the celebrations of life that provide meaning of who we are as the people of God. We are thankful for those moments, and help us in celebrating those occasions in meaningful ways to lift us, lift our spirits within us and within others. We come in prayer to lift our loved ones up with primarily with health concerns, but Lord, sharing our hearts for those that we care about, and surely there are some to be shared this morning. Debbie?
Brandon was in the hospital for the second time in the last 2 or 3 months with intestinal issues. They think he has scar tissue that's blocking where he had his colostomy, and so they're referring him on to a surgeon.
Lord, we pray for Brandon Smith and surgeries, therapies, whatever lays ahead. in a recurrence of intestinal problems.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Yes, Joy.
My son-in-law, Charles, got word last week that he will probably be stuck in South America through the holidays and won't get home till January. He's very depressed about it, but it's the way it is.
Yeah.
But, yeah, the Pritt family needs your prayers to get through the holidays.
Certainly. Lord, many times we have disappointments that we have to that we need to persevere through, and Lord, I pray for Charles, especially overseas at, on the job, and his family in the times of loneliness and sorrow, and Lord, I put them into your care as well. Lord,
hear our prayers.
Jim?
Patty Cartmill was at the emergency room Friday, and I just returned home. My prayers for her continued recovery.
Yes. Lord, we pray for Dottie as she balances out serious health concerns. We thank you for being with her in this ongoing process.
Lord, hear our prayers.
As we put ourselves into your care and put our loved ones into your care, Lord, we give thanks. And in this spirit of prayer, we remember your leading the disciples in how to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The message today talks about end times, so to speak, and teaching in that area. And we are living out some of those days, and our message in music is entitled Days of Elijah, but it talks to us about the days in which we are living are significant and have been prophesied in the Bible, and we are part of this this key time.
Of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days.
scripture reading today comes from the book of Mark, chapter 13, verses 1 through 8 and 21 through 23. It's in the New Testament, page 50 in the Pew Bibles, if you'd like to follow along, or on the back of the bulletin. Mark 13, 1 through 8 and 21 through 23. As he came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." Then Jesus asked him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down." When he was setting up the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be, and what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" Then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. This is but the beginning of the birth pangs. And if anyone says to you at this time, 'Look, here is the Messiah,' or 'Look, there he is,' do not believe it. False messiahs and false prophets will appear and produce signs and omens to lead astray, if possible, the elect. But be alert. I have already told you everything." May God add his blessings for the reading of his word.
Lots of imagery, biblical imagery, in the song we just heard about Jesus coming on a cloud at the trumpet call, and we are the workers in the vineyard, and the prophecy of Ezekiel, dry bones coming to life again. It's all interesting, isn't it? And it's one area where I believe every person of faith is interested. Okay, when is Jesus going to come again? Well, this will hopefully give a little clarification on some of our questions. At least the disciples had them too. But sometimes things that have been predicted do not happen. Maybe you've noticed that. Even I was looking again, and I hadn't thought about it, but the Mayan calendar ended, and last year with the kind of the Bethlehem star that we talked about, where the planets aligned and made a big bright star. Well, that was the end of the Mayan calendar, and so the Mayans thought that that would be the end of time there. But how about other predictions maybe gone wrong? And I'm talking about predictions from experts here. This one expert said there is not the slightest indication that nuclear energy will ever be obtainable. It would mean that the atom would have to be shattered at will. And the expert that said that was Albert Einstein in 1932. Here's one from, well, that we kind of laugh at now. The person said there is a worldwide market for maybe 5 computers. From Thomas Watson, chairman of IBM in 1943. There will never be a bigger plane built. That was from an anonymous Boeing engineer after the first flight of the 247. Wes, do you remember the 247?
I believe it was before my time.
Okay. Well, the 247 was a twin-engine plane that held, get this, 10 people.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes. Here's one I thought was interesting also. Television won't last because people will soon get tired of staring at a plywood box every night. Daryl Zanuck, movie producer of 20th Century Fox, in 1946. And from my generation, I love this one. we don't like their sound, and guitar music is on the way out. Decca Recording Company on declining to sign the Beatles in 1962. Yeah. Predictions gone wrong. And surely the disciples thought that Jesus was having a prediction going wrong. Remember last week, they were admiring the temple, and the widow put in her little bit into the temple treasury, and Jesus had a woe concerning the scribes and the leaders of the church there. Well, this week, as the disciples walked out of the temple, Jesus paused, looked back at the temple, and said to his disciples, asked them, "Do you see all these great buildings? Not one stone will be left on another." To the disciples, this would be a prediction gone wrong. Nothing can bring down these walls. "Look, teacher, what massive stones. You surely can't be serious. What magnificent buildings." And they were magnificent. In fact, the smallest stones in the structure weighed 2 to 3 tons, the small ones. Many of the stones weighed 50 tons. Today, the largest existing stone, which is part of the Wailing Wall, is 12 meters in length and 3 meters high, and it weighs hundreds of tons. The stones were so immense that mortar wasn't needed, or any other binding building material didn't have to be used. The stability was attained by the great weight of the stones themselves. The walls towered over Jerusalem in places up to 400 feet. 400 feet. How did they build that? And inside these four walls was 45 acres of a mountain-shaved flat. And during Jesus' day, 250,000 people could fit comfortably inside that area. Obviously, we kind of think of these stadiums that we see now. Nothing comes close in today's world to the temple. So you can understand then the disciples' surprise. And as they walk down the valley of the Kidron Valley and on up into the Mount of Olives, they're thinking to them, I would think they're thinking to themselves, "Jesus is really, you know, way off on this one. But just in case, I'd like some more information." So the disciples got Jesus aside and said, "What's going to be the sign when all these things are taking place?" I suspect in their voice was anxiety and fear. Fear of the unknown. Fear that their lives would be drastically changed, and they would be. Jesus hadn't made too many of these predictions, but this one's really different. And 40 years later, his prediction came true. In 70 AD, the temple was destroyed by the mighty Romans, and that prediction came to pass. What can we learn today from this scenario? Well, I believe we learn that the true solid rock of faith is not about temples or signs, but is in Jesus himself. Once again, if we go back to this first century here, from anywhere in the city, you could look up and catch a glimpse of the temple. It was a 45-year project that King Herod instituted, and it was the third temple, by the way. And the temple had been the center, not only of the worship life, but of the national life of the people of Israel, the people of God. You see, at the temple, over thousands of years, The Jews brought their sacrifices to the temple. They confessed their sins. They gave the first fruits from their harvest. They yearly sacrificed lambs for the sins of the nation. It was here that the Passover was celebrated. Pentecost was celebrated. The Day of Atonement. The Feast of Tabernacles. The Feast of Weeks. This was the heart and soul of the people of God. And with the temple so central to their worship and then their lives, the question that the disciples had to be thinking, what's going to happen? How can we worship God without a temple? How can we go on living without the temple here? That's understandable. I have noticed that many people get sentimentally tied to things. If they're lost, what are we going to do? Betty, perhaps you had that going through your mind.
I did.
Yeah. How am I going to go forward here if I lose this? If things aren't done the way that they've always been done? But even with that, the temple was unique. Unique because God himself is said to be the architect. In the book of Deuteronomy, there were exact dimensions of the altar, the grounds, the walls, the doors, all the trimmings, are down to the very size of the stones that were used to decorate. This was God's building. How could the temple be destroyed if it was God's building? Yes, this is the place where John the Baptist's birth was announced to Zechariah, where baby Jesus' preeminence was recognized by Simeon and Anna, where Jesus' religious intelligence was recognized by the leaders in the temple at Jesus' age of 12. And very recently, where the money changers were driven out by Jesus himself. This was the place where the Apostle Paul was arrested. With the temple so central to life, how could they go on? Well, Jesus answers that question. Jesus, the solid rock of faith, says that God is not found in temples or even in places of worship. Fun fact, I just want to interject this here. I found out, I guess again, I'm reminded that even after Jesus' death, Christians gave offerings and sacrifices at the temple. The Apostle Paul, in chapter 21 of Acts, it describes Paul making an offering. But Jesus says that faith is not found in temples. God's bigger than that. Also, secondly, faith is not found in signs. Tell us, the disciples insisted, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they are about to be fulfilled? Would we all really like to know? I would have to think, yes. Through the years, I've hung on to some of the predictors offerings. If you were roughly in my generation, perhaps you remember the movie The Thief in the Night. Did y'all see that? I saw it in youth group. Scared the tar out of me. But The Thief in the Night was the first movie of a four-part series of A Distant Thunder, The Image of the Beast, and The Prodigal Planet. And I showed a couple of these movies to the youth group when we had a much larger youth group because, one, I thought they'd get a kick out of seeing the fashions from the 60s. And I think they did. But this was the type of thing that was presented to me as a young person. And it had an impact on my life. And then a little bit later on, maybe you remember the Left Behind series. That's pretty, well, for some of us, pretty current. The Left Behind series. And I thought the books were well written. However, the problem for me seemed that many people thought that was scripture instead of biblical biblical fantasy or biblical fiction. So I had these movies and kept them. When I was a young teenager, the book The Late Great Planet Earth came out. Did any of you remember this book, or did you read this book by Hal Lindsey? Well, if you didn't, you missed on the number one bestseller of the decade back in the day. The decade. So, what year? 1970, and it is a reprint in 1977. Hal Lindsey. And he was talking about the world events with Russia and China coming to play and that type of thing. Once again, it's pretty interesting, but it didn't come to pass. So in 1997, Hal took another shot at it. The Apocalypse Code by Hal Lindsey. So, yeah, once again, pretty interesting. And golly, it doesn't seem possible. That was, what, 24 years ago now? But my favorite, and I've mentioned this before, was when I was serving a congregation in Cutler Ridge, Florida. A book was going around, 88 Reasons Why the Rapture Could Be in 1988. Interesting stuff. And the author had all the Jewish celebrations coalescing and coming to a head on September 11th, 12th, and 13th. 1988. So, lots of predictions out there. And what did Jesus say about these predictions? No! Don't believe these people who say they're a Messiah coming in my name. There was a TV preacher talking for a long time about his new book that supposedly explained everything a person needs to know about the coming of Jesus and end times. He said, you must have this book. He said it over and over again. You must have his book. And on the picture, there was a telephone number, not even a toll-free telephone number, but a telephone number asking you to call or telling you to call in. And for $14.95, you could have this book. And it was implied that if you didn't have this book, you would not survive the coming terrors that were to come. So, there was another pastor that called the number on the screen and suggested to the poor operator that if this preacher really thought it was so vital to the survival of the planet and that the end was so near, he would be giving the book away. Okay? I mean, you won't need money, right? It's all coming to an end anyway. Who needs a bank account? Yes, it costs money to print, but he's not going to have to pay for it. Because the end will be here. The woman on the other end of the line was not really amused. She said, sorry, sir, but I really don't know much about theology. To which the pastor responded, neither does the writer of the book you're selling. I will say this. With my whole heart, I believe that it is the greatest of all biblical mysteries. 23 out of the 27 New Testament books share about Christ's return. We don't have an indication of when, what will usher it in. The problem with predicting the second coming is that most predictions center on world events. So I will share my perspective on this. World events are not the indicators of the end times here. Wars, earthquakes, international political instability, famine, persecution. These, says Jesus, if you can believe Jesus, are not a sign of the end. They are simply facts of life that have occurred from the beginning. Do not be alarmed, Jesus says, about these. These must happen. The end is still here to come. We in our culture here are more informed on what is going on worldwide as far as wars and politics and rumors of wars. They've been going on forever. But we know more about it. I will give you, if I was alive during World War II, I would have thought this is probably going to be it. But it wasn't. So, I cannot tell you when, but I can tell you this. If you don't live with the expectation of Christ's return, you've missed something that is crucial to our Christian faith and the teachings of Jesus. The second coming of Christ is part of our life. It is who we are. It makes us watchful. It makes us cautious. And most importantly, it makes us prepared. The solid rock of faith is not in temples. It's not in the signs that people talk about so much. Signs has always been here. The solid rock of faith is our Lord Jesus Christ, and he will return sometime. Even Jesus said, I don't know when. That's reserved for the Father. Perhaps some of us older people remember Carl Reiner and Mel Brooks, comedians. They did a skit called The 2013-Year-Old Man one time, and Carl Reiner is a TV interviewer, and Mel Brooks plays the old Jewish gentleman of the faith. And at one point, Carl Reiner asked the old man, did you always believe in the Lord? Brooks replied, no, we didn't. We had a guy in our village named Phil, and for a time we worshiped him. Really? A guy named Phil? Why? Because he was big and mean and he could break you in two with his bare hands. Well, did you have prayers that you gave to Phil? Yes. Would you like to hear one? Oh, Phil, please don't be mean and hurt us and break us in two with your bare hands. So when did you start believing in the Lord? Well, one day a big thunderstorm came up and a lightning bolt hit Phil. And we gathered around Phil, and Phil died. And we said to one another, there's got to be something bigger than Phil. Yes. And that sounds a little funny, but sometimes we tend to worship things that seem big, but they're not as big as our solid rock of faith in Jesus. The disciples are told here, watch out that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name claiming I am he and will deceive many. Well, friends, there are many false predictions and false messiahs claiming to have the answers, trying to be world leaders, manipulating people, lying, recruiting people to be violent and even kill in God's name. They go by many labels. One that we probably can agree on is terrorists. But today, I want to tell you there's something bigger than Phil. So, in my opinion, our response to false prophets looks something like this. We need to be about the work which Jesus gave us to do. Work things that we know in our hearts that we should do. When Jesus was ascending to the clouds, and the disciples were looking, seeing Jesus ascend, and they turned around, and there were two angels that were there saying, "Why are you looking up there?" This is kind of a paraphrase here. But, "Why are you looking up there? You know what needs to be done. Go and do it." In various parables, Jesus suggested that when a master went out on a trip, the slaves should be found at their posts doing their work, so they would be found faithful doing what they were supposed to be doing when their master returned. So being alert for the return of Jesus means going about our normal tasks in the spirit of love and compassion. Whether it's farming in the fields, going to work, taking care of our homes, caring for family, or serving the least of these, from Matthew's 25th chapter. For my theology, the great work of the Master is that we should be feeding the hungry, giving drink to the thirsty, clothing the naked, visiting the sick, visiting those in prison, and tending to the least of these. This is the way to be prepared when God comes, when Jesus comes back on a cloud at the last trump. You know, the imagery that Paul used in talking to the churches in Corinth and Thessalonica. You see, history will sweep away the false prophets. But one day, Christ will return, and we will stand not in the bedrock of a temple made with human hands, which is there for a long time, but eventually gone. No, we take our stand with Christ, the solid rock of our faith. And we hear about it every week, I believe, when we come to the communion table. We hear Jesus' words about what he would be doing in the day ahead, his body being broken, his blood being shed, taking bread, giving thanks for the bread, he shared it. "This is my body, broken for you. Take and eat, all of you." And he talked about a new covenant. The new covenant that he said was in his blood. "This is my blood shed for your sins." And as Paul talks about this, and the gospel writers, every time we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we remember our Lord until he comes. Until he comes. That is a solid rock of faith, and we celebrate this every week when we come to the table.
invites us to his table. It's a table of love, a table of grace, and a table of remembrance. Unworthy, we come to confess our sins, our shortcomings, and to remember the sacrifice of our Savior, Jesus Christ. So in a spirit of gratitude, let us pray. Dear Father, we come with grateful hearts. We thank you for sending your Son to be our Savior. We remember his sacrifice on the cross, a brutal and painful, undeserved death, all to bring us, his undeserving people, salvation. Thank you for loving us this much. We ask your blessing on the bread and on the cup, elements signifying Christ's broken body and his shed blood. May this act of communion bring us a new spirit and a new commitment to serve you. May Christ's light shine in our lives so that others will come to know you, to know your love and your saving grace. Amen. And as we do every time we gather, let us eat of the bread, remembering Christ's broken body. And to share in the cup, remembering Christ's spilled blood.
Each week we're reminded of the many gifts that God has given us. We experience those gifts every day, not just on Sundays. We have an opportunity to return a small portion of those gifts to his use and his work here in this church and throughout the world. We invite you now to participate in the stewardship moment by giving either through placing an offering in the plate here, mailing a check or money order to the church, or by participating in Giblify online. May we pray. Oh God, we thank you so much for the many gifts that you have given us throughout our lives, each day, each week. We pray that we are always mindful of the gifts that you have given us and return a portion now to you that you might use and bless, that it might be used in your work here on this earth. In Christ's name we pray.
So whenever it happens, it'll happen. And Matthew's gospel, as I alluded to earlier, says something like this. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory, and all the nations will be gathered before him. And he will separate people from one another as a shepherd separates his sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. And the king will say to those on his right hand, come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. And I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me. And then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited to you? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, did it to me. If you're looking for a sign, a solid rock of faith to stand on, there you go. Our invitation hymn, Invitation to Discipleship, is On Christ the Solid Rock I Stand. And I love this song because it helps focus us back to the center of our faith. If you've never made a commitment or made it a priority to follow Jesus as your Lord and Savior, this is a day to step forward and make that commitment. May we stand and share this song of our faith about our hope. Solid rock of our faith. As we close our time together, please join me in our closing chorus printed in our bulletin. Sustains you and guides you in preparing for a second coming, doing the work and ministry that Jesus has given us. Amen.